So for those of you who've been tracking with us for a couple of years, you know that we actually started Emmaus studying the Gospel of Luke, and we're back in the Gospel of Luke, so what gives? Well, we're going to take a little break from our schedule because of the recent events that a lot of you are aware of. If you're not, you must not have a television, a newspaper, or a smartphone, or be on the internet. But we wanted to talk because of the recent ISIS crisis going on in the world with the recent terrorist attacks in Beirut, and also the most recent in Paris, and just some of the things that's created as a collective people. I know there's a growing uneasiness now among the American people as it concerns our relationships with the Muslim community, and also with the Syrian refugee crisis. I think all of those things coming together, the terrorist attacks in Beirut and Paris, and then the Syrian refugee crisis, I know has raised a heightened awareness. And so as a leadership group, the elders, Tony and Anthony and Adam and I, just praying and talking through how we should lean into this as a community, decided we should take some time this particular Sunday morning to address these issues. And so we're going to take some time to talk about that from a biblical perspective. For some of you who are more in the know on kind of what our schedule was looking like for this month, and we've been working up to it all last month, this morning we were actually going to have a couple of staff members from World Relief come to visit us. And World Relief, if you don't know about them, they are a global and they have a local office here in Durham. And their main ministry is to help refugees relocate into the Triangle. So we were going to have them here this morning to talk to us more about that ministry and how we can step into that as a community. But with all the turmoil that our country is experiencing on a political level and on a personal level, we thought it would be best to postpone their visit and reorient ourselves and lay some biblical groundwork around this idea of how should the church respond when the world does what the world does. And so if you've been following the news, you know this has been a big deal. If you're watching the news, maybe even for you, you started to wrestle with some of these tough questions that some of the politicians and the talking heads are wrestling with as it concerns the refugee crisis in particular, especially those coming from Syria. You're asking the questions like, is it wise to allow Syrian Muslims into our country? Or questions like, when does compassion get trumped by a responsibility to keep our country safe? Or is the vetting process, which is the big question that everyone's asking, are we properly vetting people that come into the United States to make sure they aren't Trojan horses, so to speak, coming in to launch terrorism on our own country? And then the one that I think everyone's dealing with, and that is, how should we be interacting with the Muslim community? And I don't know if you're like me, but this last week's been like an emotional pinball game. Pinball machine. Did you ever play pinball? Okay, so Rialto, California, Brian Fowler in the 1980s had a neighbor who had a pinball machine, and it was awesome. But inside, I've been an emotional pinball machine because there's so many people with so many opinions. I told Tony late this week, I said, I need to stop reading. I just need to stop reading articles because I am so confusing myself. I feel like I'm in a dilemma myself. I don't know who I am, what I think anymore because I read this article and then that article and then listen to that politician. And if you're like me and you've leaned into this, maybe you've been through the gamut of emotions and trying to process all of these things. I mean, we have on one end the presidential candidates saying what they're going to say. You have Donald Trump saying, you know what America needs to do? We need to build a big, beautiful wall around the United States borders and keep everybody out. And, you know, he put the Syrian community on notice, the refugee community on notice, that if he gets elected, he is going to send them home. So then you've got that. You've got that viewpoint, right? And on the other side, you have our current president, President Obama, saying that he's trying to pass an initiative to welcome in 10,000 refugees through an expedited process. And then if you look at the map of the not-so-united United States of America, over half of the states in the United States, the governors are petitioning not to have refugees allowed in their states. And all of these things sort of get us pulled one direction or another. I watch the news and I feel I'm pulled this way, and then I read an article and I'm pulled this way, and we can often go back and forth and back and forth. Now, with all of that said, we know everybody's got an opinion. I mean, people are full of opinions. It's amazing. And some have had personal experiences. Everybody has a set of statistics that backs up their viewpoint. So if you're pro-refugee, you have statistics for that. If you're anti-refugee, you have statistics for that. If you're pro-Muslim, against Muslim, whatever your stance be politically in this particular environment, you've got something to say about it that backs up the way that you land. And I get that. I mean, I think there needs to be space for these kinds of conversations. I don't think these things should always have to polarize and divide us. But that's what's going to happen in the world. That's happened in the United States. This isn't new to us. We've had these conversations before. We've been a united people that were not so united. We've had these discussions. But the bigger deal to me is not what the U.S. government is going to do. We need to pray for our government. We need to be responsible citizens. We need to care about our community. We need to care about our country. But as a follower of Jesus Christ, I am more a Christian than I am an American. I don't find my identity in being a patriot. And I think it's fine to be a patriot. God bless America. Go to the place where God has put you and bless that community, but your identity doesn't need to be wrapped up in that community if that trumps your identity in Jesus Christ. We need to think clearly. We need to pray seriously. We need to care as Christians, but when the Bible identifies who you and I are, it uses some interesting terms. The Bible calls us strangers, pilgrims, sojourners, resident aliens. We are people of another kingdom. So, if we're going to follow in the way of Jesus, then we have to listen to his words. In John chapter 18, verse 36, Jesus said, "My kingdom is not of this world. If it were, my servants would fight." And this had to do with him going to the cross, him overthrowing human government. Overthrow the Roman Empire, Jesus. And he says to that a resounding, "My kingdom is not of this world. If it were, then my servants would fight." And so we have to take a step back and remember that as Christians, we are resident aliens. Jesus said he was a man of the kingdom. And as he is, so are we in this world. Do you realize what you call yourself? For those of you who say, "I am a Christian," you know what that word means? It means little Christ. Actually, even more to define it, the I-A-N suffix on the end of the word Christian, Christ, I-A-N, that means belonging to the company of Christ. If you're a North Carolinian, belong to the company of those in North Carolina. If I'm an Oregonian or a South Carolinian or whatever, a Linian, then I belong to the company of all those who identify with that particular country. And so, brothers and sisters, let us not forget that you are Christian. And so the bigger question for me is not what the United States is going to do. It's what should the new kingdom people do? What should the new humanity do? What should Christianity say? How should the church respond to days such as this? Are we to avoid all Muslims? Is that what we should do? Should we be leery of refugees from Muslim countries? Would Jesus, in order to protect his friends and followers and family, refuse to engage the Muslim community, people from Syria, and all refugees from Muslim countries? And I tell you, I go either way sometimes, because there's voices and perspectives and debates and social media posts. My goodness, all of my friends that I have on Facebook think that they are politicians, apparently. They have the answers. And so my brain bounces around and around and around. But we need the scriptures to inform the way we think on these issues. And I found an article, speaking of all the articles I read this week. But this one I found was helpful for me. And I want to take the time to read it to you before we get into our text. I often look on a website for the Gospel Coalition. I like a lot of the material that they put out, and I respect a lot of their leaders. And as this Syrian refugee crisis and ISIS and the terrible terrorist attack in Paris and Beirut, the Gospel Coalition author Russell Moore put out an article entitled, "Should We Pray for ISIS to Be Defeated or Converted?" And this is what he wrote. "Over the weekend, many of us watched with horror and heartbreak as reports of terrorism came from Paris. At least 120 people were killed in what appears to be a coordinated operation by the Islamic State, ISIS, a terror organization that has murdered thousands of innocent people over the last year, including many Christians. ISIS is one of the clearest embodiments of persecution and evil that we in the West have seen in many years. Their very existence is a commitment to wiping out political and cultural opposition through violence. They prey relentlessly on the innocent, including children. There's no question that ISIS is a menace that must be engaged through just war." But is justice the only thing that Christians should pray for when it comes to ISIS? Should we pray that our military, in the words of some of you country music people will appreciate this, in the words of singer Toby Keith, light up their world like the 4th of July? Or should we pray that, as a friend of mine posted on social media, there would be a Saul among those ISIS militants whose salvation might turn the Arab world upside down with the gospel? These are not contradictory prayers, and to each of them I say, amen. Jesus says to love our enemies and to pray for those who persecute us, Matthew 5:44. The Spirit of Jesus in the prophets and in the apostles also tells us that those who turn a blind eye to the killing of others are wrong. The reason we feel contradictory praying for both justice against ISIS and salvation among ISIS is partly because we fail to distinguish between the mission of the state and the use of the temporal sword against evildoers, Romans 13, verse 4, and the mission of the church and the use of the sword of the Spirit against sin, death, and evil. But that's not, I think, the main problem. The main problem is that we sometimes forget we are called to be a people of both justice and justification, and that these two are not contradictory. It sounds awfully spiritual at first blush to say we shouldn't pray for the defeat of our enemies on the battlefield, on the field of battle, but that's only the case if the enemies aren't actually doing anything. This terrorist group is raping, enslaving, beheading, and crucifying our brothers and sisters in Christ, as well as other innocent people. To not pray for swift action against them is to not care about what Jesus said we should seek. What we should hunger and thirst for justice, a world in which murderous gangs commit genocide without penalty, is not a merciful world, but an unjust horror show. As Christians, we ought to be, above all people, concerned with justice. We don't just have the common grace motivation rooted in the image of God and the law written on the heart to care about stopping murder and justice. We also have the personal implication that's our household being wiped out in the Middle East, the very place where our church started. For us, this isn't a matter of they, it's a matter of us. At the same time, praying for the salvation of our enemies, even those committing the most horrific of crimes, isn't a call to stop praying for justice against them. The cross, after all, is not forgiveness in a contemporary therapeutic sense in which one is merely absolved of wrongdoing as though it were all a misunderstanding. The gospel does not say, don't worry about it, it's okay. The gospel points us to the cross where sin is absorbed in a substitute. God's righteous condemnation of sin is there. He does not and cannot enable wickedness, and God's mercy is also there in that he is the one who sends his Son as a propitiation for sins. He is both just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus, Romans 3:26. The gospel doesn't leave sin unpunished. Every sin is punished, either at the place of the skull, Calvary, Golgotha, in Christ, or in judgment of hell on one's own. The repentant thief on the cross, this is the part that really was interesting to me. The repentant thief on the cross, a Middle Eastern terrorist by Rome's standards, did not believe his salvation exempted him from justice. He confessed that his sentence was just, that he was receiving the due reward for his deeds, Luke 23:41, even as he cried out to Jesus for merciful entrance into this kingdom. We ought indeed to pray for the gospel to go forward, that there might be a new Saul of Tarsus, transformed from murdering to gospel witness. At the same time, we ought to pray with the martyrs in heaven for justice against those who perpetrate such wickedness, praying for the military to defeat the enemies and that they might turn to Christ aren't contradictory prayers, because salvation doesn't mean turning an eye away from justice. We can pray for rootedness in the Middle East, and we can pray to light up their world like the 4th of July at the same time. We are, after all, the people of the cross. I appreciate the fact that we're wrestling with these things, that we understand that God will eventually gain his vengeance on all people who have acted unjustly, and that we should be a people whom the book of Micah chapter 5 tells us that he has shown us, O men, what is good and what the Lord requires of us, to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with our God. But we need the Bible to help inform the way that we're processing these things as a community, a small church community, also as your individual families, and to remember we are the people of God. So here we find ourselves in this passage in Luke chapter 10, verse 25 through 37. Probably one of the most familiar texts of the parables that Jesus ever gave. The parable of the Good Samaritan. If you grew up in Sunday school like I did, you probably saw this on the flannograph board in your Sunday school class. So you're familiar with this story, but let's consider this story in light of the current things that we're going through as a church, as a community, and as individuals. Jesus, beginning to teach, on one occasion, an expert in the law stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he asked, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" You might underline that. "What is written in the law?" Jesus replied. "How do you read it?" He answered, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself." "You have answered correctly," Jesus replied. "Do this and you will live." But he wanted to justify himself. You might also note that. So he asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" In reply, Jesus said this. "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho when he was attacked by robbers. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going down the same road, and when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. So to a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, the beat-up man, he passed on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he traveled, came where the man was, and when he saw him, he took pity on him. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he put the man on his donkey, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day, he took 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper, saying, 'Look after him, and when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense that you may have.' Which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers?" The expert in the law said, "The one who had mercy on him." And Jesus told him, "Go and do likewise." That's the word of God, the parable of Jesus, of the Good Samaritan. What does this parable teach us? The most obvious lesson that I think most people have gleaned from this parable is that we should be a people who help out the beaten, broken, and downtrodden in the world. And I think that's a well-taken point. When we see people on the road of life that are in need, we should not, as James said, say, "Be warm, be filled, and do nothing." We should not, as Jesus pointed out, these two religious folk did nothing and walked around the man because they did not want to be inconvenienced or defiled. But for us, what is the lesson that we should take away as we face what we're facing in the world that we're currently living in, the world that I'm raising my children and you are raising yours? How are we to process these words of Jesus into our own situation? Well, I would say, first of all, if we're going to apply the Bible, we have to do so contextually. When you study your Bible, you have to do it in context, because any verse taken out of its context can be made to say almost anything you want it to say. So let's consider why Jesus actually told this story in the first place. We're told there was this man who maybe your translation calls a lawyer. The NIV, as I read out of, it calls him an expert in the law. So this man was schooled in the Torah and the prophets. He was the most schooled of that society. In our society, we would call him a theologian, right? That's a great word. Would you like to be called a theologian? I don't know what you do, but you're awesome. You don't have any calluses on your hand, but you read lots of books. You are a theologian. Well, this expert in the law came to Jesus for the purpose of testing him. He wanted to test the Lord. And he said, what do we have to do to inherit eternal life? Now, if you don't know this, this was a very commonly asked question in that day. They would debate this constantly. What does one have to do to have eternal life? And Jesus, as was his common approach, when he was aware that the person coming after him was a little bit snarky, that had a gleam in their eye. This was not an honest doubter. He wanted to test Jesus. He wanted to entrap Jesus. And so Jesus answers the question with another question. He says, well, what does the law say? How do you read it? In other words, volley back to you. Ball's in your court. You figure it out, big guy. I know what your agenda is. Just tell me what the Bible says. So this guy says, well, the Bible says that we're to love the Lord our God with our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and to love our neighbor as ourselves. Now, what just happened there? This lawyer answered, this expert in the law answered in a very common mantra that was spoken all over Israel twice a day. A good Orthodox Jew would say this out loud, that we're to love the Lord our God with our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and to love our neighbor as ourselves. And twice a day they would recite this. And so this was basically like my kids' memorized prayers at night. Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I should die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take. What a horrible prayer for kids to pray it. You realize how morbid that is? You know, like, kids, I'm going to teach you your first prayer to talk to Father God. My kids don't actually pray that prayer, but you know what I mean. So these guys, I mean, they could say this in their sleep. Now I lay me down to sleep. Okay, what? How do you inherit eternal life? Their common answer, twice a day, the Orthodox Jews would say, we're to love the Lord our God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and to love our neighbor as ourselves. This was basically a combination of two passages in the Old Testament, and neither one of them is taken out of the Ten Commandments. The first one is taken out of Deuteronomy chapter 6, commonly called the Great Shema, which means to hear. It starts out, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, and you should love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. The other is taken out of Leviticus chapter 19, verse 18, which that passage instructs us that we call that the golden rule, that you should love your neighbor as yourself, or do unto others as you would have them do unto you. And so this common prayer was the answer to this hanging question. What must we do to inherit eternal life? Love God with everything you are and love your neighbor as yourself. And Jesus said, that's the right answer. Now go do it. I love that. Like, he's like, I'm not going to argue with you. You're the man with all the answers. You ask me a question, I'll answer your question with another question. Then he recites this very commonly said phrase. Then Jesus just looks at him and says, then go do it. Like, that's easy to do. Now, why would that answer be the answer to the question, what must we do to inherit eternal life? Why is that the answer? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Love your neighbor as yourself. That answer is a summation of all 10 commandments. You know your commandments? You should have no other gods before him. No graven images. God's name should never be spoken in vain. Remember the Sabbath day, keep it holy. Honor your father and mother. Don't kill. Don't commit adultery. Don't steal. Number 8. Number 9, don't lie. Number 10, don't covet. Well, I mean, break them down. The first 4 have to do with loving God. Deuteronomy chapter 6. You should love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Deuteronomy 6. That's the first part of this answer to this question. What do we have to do to have eternal life? Just completely love God commandments 1-4. Well, what do we have to do on top of that? We also have to love our neighbor. The last six commandments have to do with our relationship with our fellow man. First four commandments, vertical. Last six, horizontal. How to relate to God, how to relate to man. So basically, this lawyer just hung himself. He basically just admitted to Jesus, I have to be perfect. And Jesus said, okay, you hear what you just said? Go do it. Good luck. Because if one board in the 10 is missing, the whole boat gets sunk. I mean, if you have a boat, a little canoe or something, a rowboat, and it's got 10 boards, 10 commandments, and you're like, man, like 9 out of 10, I'm pretty good. But this one board, not so much. It's got a hole in it or it's missing. Your boat is sunk. Jesus let the man sink himself. He just let him run with the rope. Go make a noose. And the guy just hung himself. Right? And Jesus is like, I'm done. Then go do it. If you can do this, then go do it. If you could do this, then you wouldn't need a Savior. I wouldn't even need to be here. If you could find eternal life, inherit eternal life in some other way, just go do the law. So then, this lawyer keeps pressing Jesus. Dumb move. Because it says, what was his motivation? He wanted to justify himself. That's why this guy is before Jesus. Now, he wants to say, I'm actually doing everything I need to do to inherit eternal life. So with that snarky smirk I'm guessing he had, he said, who's my neighbor? I mean, if I'm supposed to love God, I think I got that one down. Obviously, I'm a lawyer. I'm an expert in the law. I study Torah. I know the law. I know the prophets. Obviously, I'm loving God, right? Okay, so who's my neighbor? Like, if I got to do that one, who is my neighbor? Now, this guy, when he asked that question, he thought his neighbor were his national Jewish brothers and sisters, his family, and his friends. And so in his mind, he's thinking, I got him. I am okay before God because I love my family and my national Jew, and I love the guy that actually lives next door to me. So loving neighbor category, check, off the hook. I mean, just ask my mom or ask my friend Joe or ask my neighbor Bob. I do love my neighbor as I love myself. And Jesus then says, oh yeah, here's the story. There was probably a Jewish man who was walking this precarious path from Jericho to Jerusalem, this precarious, infamous path for thieves and robbers. It was called the path of Adumim, which means blood. It was the bloody path, notorious. You don't want to walk this path. Well, this man, not given a name in the story, probably Jewish in nationality, is walking the bloody path. Walking the path of Adumim, and some hoods, some gangsters, some thugs jump the dude. And they beat him up and leave him half dead. So now you think of this man. Think of this man beat up on the bloody path. He has nothing in which he can use to help himself. They've taken his money. They've stripped him of his clothes. He doesn't have any physical strength. This man is your ultimate refugee. He's had the mess kicked out of him. And he's laying on the road in a pool of his own sweat and urine and blood. That's the story. And along the bloody path, along Adumim, comes a priest. Now immediately, the lawyer in the listening audience is going, aha, I know how this is ending. The priest is going to do something awesome for this guy. And it's just going to prove how righteous I am. Because in Jesus' day, the priest was varsity. I mean, the priest was like ultimate. That this is the man of our community. When you think priest, think pastor combined with community leader combined with scholar, all wrapped up in one. The priests were, they were like the representation of everything that Judaism was. So these guys are automatically thinking, this guy's going to save the day. And Jesus says, the priest walked by the beat up man on the side of the road, and he walked on the other side to avoid him. The Greek could actually translate this. He turned and walked and went the other way. He turned his face away. He turned his back to the brokenness that he saw in life. He said, I don't have time for this. Probably had a justification for it. All we know is that the priest did nothing. Now, that's shocking in the ears of an Israelite, not that guy. That guy always gets it right. They're supposed to get it right. That's their job. That's their life. Well, Jesus says, well, the next character to come along was a Levite. Oh, a guy from the tribe of Levi, a temple servant. Like, this guy's going to surely save the day. He'd be our equivalent of a church staff member. Like, okay, the deacon in the church, like, he's got to do something. The guy's beat up. He's left half dead. He's naked and beat, and he's on this bloody path. Like, the Levite, the priest bombed out, but the Levite's got to do something. And just like the man before him, he also went around and avoided the man. Or, as the Greek in that could also be put, he turned around and went the other direction. Awesome. That's religion. What does that even mean? In one fell swoop, Jesus basically just unraveled the religious system of the day. Your church means nothing. You don't help the beat up man on the side of the road? What do you got? I mean, and everybody there is like, priest, Levite, like, yeah, like varsity, junior varsity. These are like the studs. These are like black belt. Like, these are serious spiritual people. And Jesus said, essentially to this lawyer, he's like, well, what I'm trying to tell you is that being a priest, being a Levite, actually means nothing as it concerns loving your neighbor if you don't love your neighbor. You can quote Leviticus 19:18 until you're blue in the face twice a day, but if you don't actually do it, you don't love your neighbor, right? It's not the saying of it, it's the doing of it. And then, here's what happens. It's like my kids always say this at home when they're telling a story or whatever. They love to say, plot twist. So this guy's already like, what are you, oh Jesus, how could you even insult the religious system that's currently standing in the day? To say those guys did nothing for the beat up man on the side of the road. I mean, we quote the great Shema. We quote Leviticus 19:18. Yeah, but you don't do it. Who are you kidding? When push comes to shove, you're nice to your mom, your neighbor Joe, and your friend Bob. That's not what the commandment means. Everybody can be nice to their friend Joe and their neighbor Bob and their mom. I mean, unless you got a really bad mom. I mean, most of us are pretty nice to our mom. So then Jesus says, but then there was this Samaritan. Now you're like, so? Because Samaritan doesn't bother you. You're like, that's an old story. I mean, you've heard the word Samaritan before, I'm sure, many of you. Samaritan, in our ears, doesn't mean anything. You know what means something to us? What if I said Syrian? I don't know how you reacted to that. They reacted to Samaritan the way that you would react to Syrian. Why? The hostility was as bad between the Samaritans and the Jews as it is today between the United States and Syria. It was maybe even a little bit more loaded. This is a longer history of fighting. Who are the Samaritans? You have to go back a little bit in history to find out who they were, but during a period of time when the 10 northern tribes were taken into captivity, they were actually hauled away by a people called the Assyrians. And if you don't know anything about the Assyrians, I would not bring up some of their atrocities in front of a mixed company because they did some things that were so awful to the Jewish slaves that they shouldn't be talked about. You can just read about them if you really want to get gnarly. But the things that they did that we can talk about is when they took their victims, they would literally string them together and put hooks in their jaws, strip them down naked, and haul them in to their country as slaves with hooks in their jaw, stripped down naked and humiliated in a chain of slaves. When they arrived there, many of the slaves were killed, skinned alive. They would use their skin for furniture. They'd make furniture out of the skin of human beings. It sounds like Nazi Germany. In front of the capital of Assyria, which was a place called Nineveh, there were skulls stacked in front of the city of their victims, those whom they had brought into slavery. And basically, it was a signpost saying, don't mess with the Assyrians. So what's a Samaritan? A Samaritan is a half-breed Jew. When the 10 northern tribes were brought into captivity in Assyria, the men raped the women, the Jewish women, and impregnated many of them. and they had little children that weren't 100% Jew. They were half-breeds. They were called Samaritans. That poor kid. Not his fault, his idiot biological sperm donor raped a woman. He's just a byproduct of the place he was born in, at the time he was born in it. He or she, that Samaritan. And so the Samaritans, though, became a hated people group. I mean, it's the equivalent, if we can think back in our own more recent story of what things that we can get our arms and minds around, think of Nazi Germany in the 1940s. During World War II, it'd be like a German Nazi soldier raping a Jewish woman and the byproduct of that child, a half German, half Jew. And let's say they started their own people group. That would not be a liked people group. It would represent the assault of their enemy. That's who the Samaritans were. Not a popular people group. The Orthodox Jews hated the Samaritans so much, they would not go through Samaria. And if you looked on your maps, if you're traveling in Israel from north to south or from north to south or south to north, whatever direction you were going, up or down, the easiest and fastest way is to go right through Samaria. But rather than that, they would go miles out of their way because they didn't even want the dust of that city on their feet. They did not want to do anything with Samaria. Is that the way Jesus felt about the Samaritans? The Jews hated them. Of that there can be no doubt. How did Jesus feel about the Samaritans? Well, John chapter 4, when John is explaining the narrative of Jesus traveling, he said Jesus must go through Samaria. Because there was a woman there who he was going to talk to by the well. You remember that story? And all the men from the town were going to come out. And he would look to his disciples and say, "Don't say 3 months and then comes the harvest. Lift up your eyes. Behold, the fields are white with harvest." He was talking about the Samaritans coming in. That's your harvest field, disciples. Go at it. Those guys were Jews. They're half-breeds. We hate them. Jesus said, "I must go through Samaria." Later on, they tried to insult Jesus with the worst insult they could in John chapter 8, verse 48. And they said to Jesus, "Aren't we right in saying that you are a Samaritan and you are demon-possessed?" They just brought the two worst things that they could think of. The most hated race and demons. You have them both. You're a demon-possessed Samaritan. That's trash talk in the first century. You know what's interesting how Jesus responded? You can read it in verse 49 of John chapter 8. They said, "Aren't you demon-possessed and aren't you a demon-possessed Samaritan?" And he said, "I'll tell you this, I'm not demon-possessed." You know what he didn't say? He never said, "I'm not a Samaritan." Now, do we think Jesus was Samaritan by race? No. We don't think Joseph was an Assyrian. But you know what he was saying by saying, "I'm not demon-possessed. I'm not bothered that you would associate me with that hated people group. I'd be a Samaritan. They would be at my dinner table. I would serve water to them at a well. I would be served by a Samaritan woman. I got no problem with the Samaritans. So what's your problem?" And so then Jesus goes, okay, so here's how this goes. The priest and the Levite won't help. That's religion. Religion won't help the beat up man. But the Samaritan is going to become the hero of the story. That's thrashing the Jews. They don't appreciate this at all. There's tension in the room. Jesus is making enemies right now. He doesn't care. He wants to win all men, but he's not afraid of offending some. I don't like offending people. I can be, at times, someone who wants to please others. I don't want people mad at me. But if I'm going to follow the way of Jesus, I try to love all men, and I may have to offend some. I've been offended by Jesus, so you get to join my club. We all get to be offended by some of the things Jesus says. So Jesus says, here's this Samaritan. And this Samaritan, probably seeing this beat up man on the road who was a Jew, who would not just be a friend, wouldn't be a friend, would be a stranger, but not just a stranger, but an enemy. So now a Samaritan sees an enemy on the side of the road who's beat up in need of his help. Does he walk around him? Nope. He picks up the man. And literally it says he begins to wrap him and bandage him, probably taking his own clothes and ripping them into shreds. So he takes his own coat off or his own shirt off. He goes shirtless and he starts ripping his own clothes into shreds. And he begins to bandage this man's wounds. And he pours into his wounds oil for soothing and wine as an antiseptic. So he does some CPR, some first aid. He revives this man. And then he puts him on his own donkey. Means he has to walk. And then he walks this man to an inn where he pays 2 denarii and says, innkeeper, take care of this man. And literally, it's probably that this Samaritan stayed with the man through the night. His first night in the inn, this stranger, this enemy, he actually spends the night with him, caring for his needs, giving him water, making sure he doesn't die, that he cools the fever or whatever he had to do in the inn. And before the Samaritan man left, after he had bent over backwards, he said, I'm going to be back. I've got business to attend to, but I'm going to come back. And when I come back, whatever he owes, I will pay it. Take care of this man. And then Jesus asks the loaded question. Who of these three was actually a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers? Now look at how this religious guy answers the question. He says, the one who had mercy on him. You notice what he couldn't say? Syrian? Samaritan? No, we'll call him the one who had mercy on him. And then Jesus leaves this thing hanging. He says, go and do likewise. The Samaritan is the example of how Jesus said you should love your neighbor. Then all he says to this religious guy, this expert in the law, go do the same thing. Go live the way the Samaritan did. So Jesus has just in one fell swoop through this story derailed this self-righteous religious man. Because this guy was thinking, I do love my neighbor. I love my mom and my physical Jewish neighbor and my friends. But Jesus said, no, you have to love not just your friends, not just strangers. This is a story of lavish love for an enemy. When have I ever loved somebody like this? I've loved myself like this. If it was me beat up and broken, I'd do everything I could to make sure I got back on the mend. If it was my wife or my kids or some of you, no, I'm just kidding. Most of you, right? You're Christians, right? You go to Emmaus. I owe it to you. Thanks for coming here. You're beat up. I'll take care of you. But when have I ever had an enemy? When have I really ever had an enemy? I mean, a real enemy, not just someone who just snubs me at work or whatever. I'm talking about someone who was after my life, who really wanted to ruin my life. I don't have enemies. But if I did, and when I do, would I do this for them? Someone that I knew hated me, a beat-up Jew on the side of the road, hates a Samaritan. Why would you help that guy? He hates you. He wishes you were that beat-up person on the side of the road. Jesus said, go live like that, and then you can have eternal life. That's what Jesus expects from us. Now, like I said, he just derailed this guy. Because this guy obviously wasn't living like this. He hated the Samaritan. He didn't love his enemies. But Jesus wants from his kingdom people that we would be a people that love the stranger, that love our enemies, that care for the hurting and the broken in the world, that we would not be bigoted or racist against anyone. And this has always been God's heart. Back in Deuteronomy chapter 10, verse 18, we have to see that it's God's nature to love like this. God said this, the Lord defends the cause of the fatherless and the widow and loves the foreigner residing among you, giving them food and clothing. That sounds like taking care of refugees. The very next verse, God states what he expects from his people. Verse 19, you are to love those who are foreigners, for you yourselves were foreigners in Egypt. Now Jesus moves this even a step further. He goes from help the fatherless, the widow, the foreigner, to listen to his words in Matthew chapter 5. And I get that there's tension in this, but I didn't write this book. I didn't. You can ask my wife. I did not write this book. Jesus said, Matthew 5, verse 43, you've heard that it says, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. That's what they were saying in those days. It's okay to hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies. Pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your Father in heaven. He causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good, and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. If you love those who love you, what reward will you get? Are not even the tax collectors doing that? Doesn't everybody love people that love them? And if you greet your own people, what are you doing more than others? Don't even the pagans do that? Isn't everybody friends to their people? I mean, I like having my people, but if they're the only people I'm nice to, I'm not doing much more than the pagans. I'm not doing much more than the tax collectors and sinners. Then Jesus adds this. How's this one? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. I'm sunk. I'm sunk, brothers and sisters, because I have people I don't like. There are people today that I know I have a problem with. There are groups of people, there are thought processes I don't like, and there are political points of view that I don't like, and yet Jesus says it's not just about being friendly to your friends, it's about loving your enemies. You know what Jesus is doing though? He's setting us up to need him. He's basically saying, what I'm asking you to do, you can't do. Pressure relief valve. Jesus was trying to sink you. When Jesus gives you a command like this, it's like you're a drowning person. And rather than a life raft, he throws you a brick. And a lot of us are like, I can handle this brick while I'm drowning in this water and got cramps and I'm going to die. So you hold onto the brick and say, I've got to do this. And you're sinking to the bottom. Because Jesus said, I never wanted you to try to do this on your own. You need a fresh encounter with Jesus Christ so that he can live his life through you. So if he asks you to do something, it isn't go off on your own and try to be the great neighborly Mr. Rogers person that you know you're supposed to be and love your enemies. Jesus is saying, I see you out there drowning in your sea of depravity. Well, Lord, how do I get eternal life? How can I be saved? And he's like, here's a brick. Go completely, perfectly, do everything that the law says. Oh, I can try that? Yeah, right. Come on. Let's be honest here. You know what? Jesus made the law harder. He didn't make it easier. Kind of our image of Jesus is gentle Jesus, meek and mild. He's a hippie that wears a dress and drinks herbal tea. No. Jesus said things like, oh, you've heard it said that you're supposed to love your neighbor and hate your enemy. I'm saying no. You can't hate your enemy. You have to do good to your enemy. I want you to be perfect. Jesus says things like, you've heard it said that if a man commits adultery, that you're not to commit adultery. But I tell you, if you look on a woman to lust after her, you've done it already. You might as well mark commandment number 7 off your list of things you've done or haven't done. You have committed adultery. You've heard it said that you should not murder. I tell you, if you're angry with someone in your heart, if you have burning anger towards someone, you have committed murder in your heart. You're guilty of murder. Jesus did not make it easier. For what reason? Because he doesn't expect you to live without him. And if you try, you will fail. And so will I. You know what Jesus is after? He's after you falling down on your face and saying, oh God, I can't do this. I can't. I can't be the man I'm supposed to be. I cannot love people the way I'm supposed to love people. I can't love you as lovely as you are the way I'm supposed to love you with all my heart and soul and mind and strength. And don't trick yourself. You can't. Don't convince yourself that you can or you end up like this silly lawyer. And the only thing Jesus had to say for him is go do it. If that's how you're going to do, then do it. The best thing you and I can do is say, God, bring regeneration to me. You know what regeneration is? It's a biblical word. It means God gives you a new heart. That's what we need, brothers and sisters. I don't need some pastor to tell me I need to love certain people that I don't love. Because you know what? Everyone here who's having a hard time with Muslims and Syrians is not listening to me right now. They're like, you don't know your facts. Where have you studied, sir? What do you know? I've got my set of statistics. You know, I'm saying, fine, like, I get that. Like, I'd love to talk with you. What I'm saying to you, though, is I'm not the one to tell you how you should act in this situation. All I'm telling you is if you're going to act like Jesus, you need his heart. I can't command life into any of us. I can't command life into my own life. I need the miracle of regeneration. And then I'm going to live out of the heart that Jesus gives me. Ezekiel chapter 36, 26 and 27. Perhaps I've referred to this verse more than almost any other as it concerns how God saves us. Ezekiel 36, 26 and 27. God said, a new heart I will give you, a new spirit I'm going to put within you, and I will take out the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you a heart of flesh, and I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes. Christianity is not about me telling you what to do in situations like the one we find ourselves in. Christianity is a heart transplant. I say this, let Jesus give you a new heart and do whatever you want because you're going to live out of your new heart. I'm not worried about trying to micromanage your life. If it doesn't line up with the Bible, then you're not living out of your new heart. But with the new heart, when God removes the stony heart and puts in a fleshly heart, guess what? With it, you get a new master. With it, you get new desires. With the new heart comes a whole new identity. So then in the new covenant, it's not a matter of God writing his will on stony tables, but writing his will on the fleshly tables of your heart. In the kingdom, it's not about someone telling you what to do, but you hear a voice behind you saying, this is the way, walk in it. I believe in people that have new hearts. I believe in a people that have new hearts, that they don't need someone to always tell them what to do. And sometimes you might wrestle. And when I talk to people who are wrestling, the question that's asked to me all the time and that I'm asking others is deep down, drown out all the noise of every voice in your heart of hearts, what do you really know you're supposed to do about this situation? Most times people know. Now I get it, you can get emotional or you can get confused or life can kind of swirl you around, but alone, quiet with Jesus, when you say, about the situation, Jesus, what am I supposed to do? People with new hearts already know. That's the gospel of Jesus Christ. He gives you a new heart and says, now go live out of it. And you know when you're living after your lesser desires. You have two sets of desires, your greater desires and your lesser desires. Your lesser desires are the desires that you were programmed from birth to live out of. That's just your nasty carnal flesh. But guess what happens to me? And it probably has happened to many of you. When Jesus regenerated my heart, all of a sudden, I wanted to do things I didn't used to want to do. I wanted to read the Bible. I wanted to pray with people I didn't even know. I wanted to attend my church. I didn't used to want to attend my church. I found within my new heart, new desire, a new capability to walk with God. And so I say all of this with all of these things together to say this. I don't know what you're supposed to do about any of this stuff with Muslims and refugees. I'm just saying live out of the heart that Jesus gave you. That's the Emmaus stance. We are not a lording over elder group. We're not going to tell you what to do. We will instruct you from Scripture. We will suggest things. We might even give our opinions. But at the end of the day, my opinion matters nothing to you. I hope you can really receive that. If it's my opinion, you can do what you want with it. You might be like, I agree with that. I don't agree with that. That's fine. When it's God, you got to wrestle with Him and live out of your new heart. Amen? That's all I'm asking. I'm asking for us to be a people who can live out of our new heart and be nice to each other. Be kind to each other. Seek to love as Jesus taught us to. You'll never regret. Of the things you're going to regret in your life, showing love, you're not going to regret that. You know, I was telling Adam, and then we're going to move into a time of baptism. How will I transition from here? I've told this story before, but the pastor of the church at Smyrna, a guy named Polycarp, was actually a disciple of the Apostle John. He was burned alive at 86 years old because he wouldn't bow down and say Caesar is Lord. But you can read several versions of the story, but as you trace the story, one of the things that was significant about Polycarp, he was such a nice man, such a kind soul. And when the soldiers came to take Polycarp away where they were going to burn him alive in the city square. He fed them breakfast. He made them breakfast. These guys were going to kill him, and he had breakfast with them. And I started thinking about the psalmist, you know. Psalm 23. He said that the Lord prepares a table before me in the presence of my enemies. And I thought, man, am I scared of my enemies? Do I hate my enemies? Or could I say with the psalmist, in the presence of my enemies, God has set a table? Could I do what Polycarp did? Invite people who wanted me dead in for breakfast? Make them some eggs and hash browns and bacon? Probably not Jewish people wouldn't do that. We're not to live in fear. Be wise, but perfect love casts out fear. Fear has torment. God has not given us a spirit of fear, but power, love, and a sound mind. I believe in you guys. I believe Christ in you. I believe you're going to do the right thing. Well, what is the right thing? I don't know. Live out of your new heart. Let Jesus talk to you. I'm not your master. I'm your friend, hopefully. Hopefully.